And now, a thought from Geico Motorcycle.
It took 15 minutes to take a spirit animal quiz online.
Please be the cheetah. Please be the cheetah.
And learn your animal isn't the cheetah, but the far less appealing blobfish.
Oh, come on.
To add insult to injury, you could have used those 15 blobfish minutes to switch your motorcycle insurance to Geico.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on motorcycle insurance.
Geico presents yet another voicemail from your roommate.
Hi! So, about the kitchen. Turns out, when there's a grease fire, you're not supposed to throw water on it. Who would have known, right? Anyways, the fire department is here, and it's totally cool. Give me a call back when you get a chance.
The Geico Insurance Agency could help keep your personal property protected, like if danger is your roommate's middle name. Visit geico.com to see how easy it is to switch and save on renter's insurance.
Did you grow up with the NES, PlayStation, Star Wars, cartoons, and ABC TV? Do you like to think who would win in a fight between Batman and the Master Chief? Comics, games, movies, music, and TV, they're gonna tell you everything you need. Superheroes or not, they got your back. They're gonna save the world of geeks. Comics, games, movies, music, and TV, they're gonna tell you everything you need. Superheroes or not, they got your back. They're gonna save the world.
It's Jamie, Progressive number one, number two employee. Leave a message at the... Hey, Jamie. It's me, Jamie. This is your daily pep talk. I know it's been rough going ever since people found out about your a cappella group, Mad Harmony, but you will bounce back. I mean, you're the guy always helping people find coverage options with the Name Your Price tool. It should be you giving me the pep talk. Now get out there, hit that high note, and take Mad Harmony all the way to Nationals this year! Sorry, it's pitchy.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
It's that time again. Time for another Turd or Treasure. And I'm going to the original plan that I had had where I wanted to have this be a weekly show where it had become basically a monthly roundup collecting the reviews that we couldn't get into the main show. And I thought, you know what? I want to bring it back to what I originally planned, which is me talking about either specific TV shows or our individual topics with shorter... maybe a couple of reviews per episode, make it come out weekly or bi-weekly at the latest. So we're going to try that this week. I've got two reviews for you, as well as a couple topics that I want to talk about in the middle of the show. Those topics being my experience with digitizing and basically how filming techniques have gone and improved for home videos across all the years. And then I also want to talk about sort of some stuff that I've purchased for myself that hasn't necessarily been provided for review that I wanted to talk about on the television and movie front. And then we'll close out the show, and that's going to be the routine. It's going to be quicker, you know, maybe more bite-sized episodes so we can keep on top of things and not have to, you know, collect it all at the end of the month sort of thing. So the two reviews I have for you this week are the Kirby's Extra Epic Yarn for 3DS, as well as World War Z on the Xbox One X. So, without further ado, let's get into Kirby's Extra Epic Yarn.
Basically, he was a geek.
Leave me alone, geek boy.
Holy shit, you geeks are badass.
Got a quick one here for you. This is Kirby's Extra Epic Yarn for the 3DS console. This is a game review that I wanted to have out earlier, but I had had, to give a bit of background story, a bit of an issue with my 2DS XL, the new 2DS XL. And I was using it fairly regularly for reviews and everything in the summer and fall. And one day I just opened it and the screen cracked from the inside. No cosmetic damage on the outside. You know, I kept very, very good care of it. It just, for whatever reason, decided to go kaput on the inside. And I had contacted Nintendo, and they were gracious enough to repair my media console for me. There were some delays in getting it around and back and everything, so we went on to reviewing other things. And then my system came back to me in pristine working condition. You know, they replaced the screen and everything. So kudos to them. If you ever need anything done, don't be afraid to contact Nintendo. And, you know, because this was a press account, you know, it was fixed for me for my review copy so I could complete them. But in general, they're very polite and very great. And, you know, you can get your stuff fixed. So putting that aside, I finally got around to reviewing my copy of Kirby's Extra Epic Yarn. And I had not played the original version that was, you know, on home consoles a few years back. So, you know, basically this is an enhanced port. It basically adds additional abilities. There's a devilish mode and sub games. There's also amiibo support. Using any Kirby related amiibo will grant you new hats and abilities. So I don't need to go into particularly if you've played the original, you know, what the story is. The plot is everything is made out of yarn. And it's just, it's a really interesting aesthetic for the game, and it works perfectly on the handheld mode just because. You know, the graphics, they scale properly. You can take it on the go. And I'm just really happy to be playing it with something I can do on the go. And it did port very, very well from being, you know, originally on a home console on the Wii. And, you know, the graphics are great. Everything's great. Basically, what I just want to get into with it is how does it handle? And is it a worthy port? It, you know, this late in the life cycle of the 3DS where it seems like Nintendo is scaling it down. You know, they had said now for the last couple of years that, oh, no, they're doing a multi-pronged thing where there's the Switch and the 3DS, you know, but you can see from the release schedule that they are releasing less and less on the 3DS. So basically, is it worth still picking up? Is it worth picking up for your 3DS now? The answer is yes. Visually, it's one of the most stunning looking games on the platform. Audio-wise, I didn't notice any major audio compression issues or anything, so it sounds great. The controls are perfect, and it just has that fun Kirby feel. So it's priced, you know, obviously cheaper than what you get for a Switch game. So it's something that, you know, if you haven't been playing your 3DS for a while, dust it off. If you are an avid 3DS gamer and you're still playing all the time, you know, it's a no-brainer. It's a Kirby game. You know what you're getting. That being said, Kirby and Yoshi and all those offshoot games lately have been having these really great, neat mechanics. When, you know, with Crafted World, you had a world made out of completely, you know, paper arts and crafts. Epic Yarn is an entire world made out of fabric, and it's just absolutely fantastic. So, you know, give it a try. Pick it up, you know, either digitally from the Nintendo eShop or pick it up retail, because you don't know how many more of these gems you're going to get on the system, and it's definitely one that's taken advantage of the mature, you know, the mature lifespan of the system, and it's taking advantage of everything that the 3DS can do. Alrighty, and we are back. So we're going to go into sort of the meat and potatoes of the episode. It won't be a long ramble, but it'll be sort of my thoughts on a few different topics. The first one being how home video has changed over the years, basically. You know, my experience with it has been simply because I'm putting together wedding video and footage and stuff for my brother's wedding coming up in the next few weeks, and I had to go back and digitize some old home videos, and some of them were on different formats, basically. So growing up as a kid, like, we weren't rich or anything. No, we didn't have money in our family. My grandfather was a teacher in the Toronto School Board, and he also had a part-time job because, you know, he had a million kids. Like, he had eight kids or whatever back in the day, and teachers didn't make nearly what they make now comparatively. So he had a second job where he worked at like a Radio Shack type hi-fi store, and he was always super into music. Like, he had reel-to-reel players. He played in the Toronto Symphony Orchestra back in the 50s. So he was very, very interested in always having the best technology when it came to video and audio. And he was one of those guys that was finding ways to record the most amount of audio and video as possible. So he started losing his eyesight in the 80s due to cataracts and stuff. And he had some operations to fix it, and it gave him more sight until the late 90s again. But he was a big classical big band fan because he was born in the 30s. So he used to, interestingly enough, instead of using cassette tapes, which had like a 60-minute limit to record, full symphony, recordings, or whenever the radio would play like a full symphony or something on the old band radio, he had a hi-fi VHS player hooked up to the radio. And he did that because he was able to record, 4 to 6 hours of straight music on one tape. It wouldn't play any visual back, but it wasn't like the most hi-fi thing possible, but he was able to get a stereo recording track uninterrupted for 4 to 6 hours when he put it on SLP slow mode, which would normally degrade the quality of the video, but didn't really affect the audio that much. So that was little, life hack sort of things that my grandfather would do that I learned from. And, he was always on top of the newest technology. He passed away in 2004. But prior to that, he was always on top of things. He had already picked up a DVHS player, which was a digital VHS 1080i full high definition VHS player, which only had a few releases, I believe, here in 2002 or 2003 before it completely died. Somebody in the family has that. I wish I had it. But basically, it was a VHS player that hooked up through component video and had the D Theater logo on it, and that would let you play tapes. I only ever bought one for it, and I was going to play it at his place before the player went missing, which I still think one of my uncles might have taken it. But I had Ghost Dog starring Forrest Whitaker. And basically what it was it was a digital tape that I was identical to VHS, but in every look and everything, but when it played back in the player, could do 1080i video with Dolby or DTS digital audio on the same track. So you could, it had chapters, so you could pick a chapter and it would auto fast forward to the spot you needed to go to and so on. So it predates Blu-ray and HD DVD by several years. So this is kind of cool. So that's just an example of how my grandpa was on top of things and trying to be, way ahead of the curve on a lot of different digital formats. He even had, I think, some Super Audio CDs, which is another audio format that is still around, but it's very, very niche and audiophile high end. He would have loved to see what Blu-ray audio became and what full digital audio became later on. But anyway, getting back to the home video, he had two different camcorders when I was growing up. There was a VHS camcorder that took VHS tapes, and he quickly tossed that aside for another shoulder mount one that was Video 8. Now, Video 8 had roughly the same quality, maybe even slightly better quality than VHS tapes did, and they were in smaller compact size. A little smaller in width than a cassette, but like an audio cassette, but a little thicker. So they were a little more robust, and they could fit into a smaller package, meaning you could use less batteries, and batteries could last longer when using them because it was less tape that had to spool and so on and so forth. I knew people that had VHS-C, which was the smaller version of VHS, but it was incompatible with the format. So basically, most of our home videos when I was a little kid, like a baby up until I was about 10 or 11 or so, were done on these Video 8 tapes, or eventually my grandpa went and got a high 8 camcorder, and that is when they shrunk it down to a palm size one. And interestingly enough, the palm size one, while being more convenient to hold, was obviously more susceptible to shaking, so it's kind of been a pain in the ass digitizing everything. So after that, I remember being in high school, and around 2003 to 2005 or so, I took film classes in school, and we used high 8 camcorders, and the teacher that I had also used digital 8. Now, digital 8 was the sort of extension of that. They basically high 8 tapes, but they happened to record digitally, so you could get, 480. Basically, it was 480i interlaced, or if you had a higher-end CCD, 3CD chip camera, we're talking like a couple $1,000s, like the one teacher had, you could record at 480p. So you could record progressive and in true widescreen. So I was experimenting with that. Most of the other kids weren't allowed to, but I was that kid that would skip other classes to go hang out in the AV room. I did some stuff that probably, well, we could have gotten in trouble. The teacher could have gotten in trouble, but he's retired now. He had a bunch of G3 computers, you know, the old Macintosh computers. The lab was basically G3s. They were those blue see-through Macs or iMacs, you know, when they had the full monitor. He had a whole bunch of those, and the problem with them was they were broken down. They were already several 5 or 6 years old at that point, and they were not really good for doing a lot of the video editing. It would take hours to, like, literally for anybody listening now that's younger, that, you know, edits on their phone or on their computer really fast, to do like standard def editing, you would import it. How he did it was he put the high 8 tape, which was analog, into a digital 8 player, and it could actually digitize it automatically and then put it on the computer. But the data rate was like 20 or 25 megabytes per second, and these computers had tiny hard drives, so you could only record maybe 20 minutes at a time and edit before you had to shrink it down and lower the quality, unless you used one of his brand new, he had a 1G5, which was the big Mac, you know, the big steel tower. It was dual core, dual CPU, you know, 2 gigahertz. Like, it was like a $6,000 computer that he had there to edit. And nobody got to touch it except for me, because I went and took the old computers. He had about 10 that were dead sitting at the side of the room that the board office wouldn't fix. And I took out all the RAM out of them, did some testing. I basically doubled or tripled the RAM in the remaining computers. Some of them had slightly better video cards that were attached to them. Took them out, upgraded the ones that were in the currently working computers, and I basically gave him an extra 2 years of life, at least till about 2007. I was out of school by then, but he was using those computers for an extra few years where he wouldn't have been able to, and he could actually edit with them, and he was very thankful. So I got to basically hang out there. He would vouch for me with my other teachers, because I took an extra year where I was short one credit from graduating, because I took two spares in grade 11 and grade 12, and my guidance counselor didn't catch that I was one credit short doing that. So instead of staying for one semester to take one course, I took an extra year and took some extra random courses because I wasn't sure what I was going to do. And so some of those classes I didn't need to graduate, so I would skip them. I hated yearbook. I hated one of the other shop classes I had that was just sort of a joke. So I would spend all my time in the AV room doing video editing and filming and learning techniques. So I basically became that guy. Like, if you couldn't see me in my class, teachers knew that I was in the AV room editing or fixing computers and cleaning them and doing that sort of crap. So teacher let me use a lot of his more expensive equipment because he trusted me with them. So that's where I learned about all those different formats. And when I was there, it was right when Mini DV was hitting its stride, around 2004, 2005. And I picked up my first camcorder from my first part-time job where I worked at Sobeys, a grocery store, stocking shelves at night. That was interesting, doing the night shift for Fridays and Saturdays, 8-hour shifts at night, and then having to be at school on Monday. So I only did that for about 6-7 months, and then I had to quit because it was really, really hard to do night shift as a teenager and then go to school full-time. So I did enough that I was able to purchase my first camera for, I think I paid about $400 or $500, and that included the Panasonic, I forget the model name, I actually have it here. It's a mini DV camera, and the big deal was it had threads on it so I could put different lens caps on it. Not, it wouldn't replace the main lens, but I could add lens filters to do wide angle lenses and stuff. So I did that, got a lighting kit for it and all that, and I filmed my school videos on there, and I was able to edit on my Mac Mini when I got the first generation Mac Mini that was the G4, G5 single core Mac Mini. And it was amazing. Teacher couldn't believe how small it was. And by today's standards, it's actually a little smaller in space than what the current ones are, because with the RISC-based CPU they used, they were actually able to make those smaller. So it was kind of fun that I was able to... I used to bring my computer with me, my entire fucking computer, to school, plug it into the school system. Teachers didn't know that I even had it hooked up there, except for that one teacher. Connect to the network and do all my video editing on there. My little Mac was more powerful than 3 or 4 of the G3 full tower computers they had to use to edit. So the teacher was okay with that, as long as I was just editing my stuff and I wasn't doing anything I wasn't supposed to, like playing games, which I did anyway. So I learned how to edit on, and the mini DV tapes, they're even smaller than the digital 8 or the high 8 tapes, but they were of much higher quality and more robust. So I was able to, and they recorded at a higher data rate, better audio, all that sort of junk. So I used the mini DV tapes for a long time. And then I'm bringing this up because I found my mini DV tape that had some of my school projects on it, and I was digitizing that. So after that, everything switched over to being pretty much, you had two options. There were DVDs, the mini DVDs you could record to with camcorders, and they were kind of crap. So I'm not even going to bother really with them. But they switched to either having hard drives built in, which were prone to eventually fail. But it was a good idea for a lot of storage because you could get maybe 60 gigs on there. And 60 gigs was as much as some of the computers had at the time. So you could record a whole lot of data, keep it on your camera, and only back up what you needed to by plugging it in. And the advantage with a camcorder that recorded to a hard drive instead of a tape was you didn't have to play it at normal playback speed or play it at fast forward speed to record it through like a mini DV. You were able to back up the file directly using FireWire, which is what the other more digital cameras like mini DV and Digital 8 used. That you plugged a FireWire cable in and it could fast forward through the tape at 2 or 3 times the speed and record the data over. Whereas with the previous analog ones, you had to wait second by second, watch it record like you were capturing from a capture card, like you would from an Elgato. So from there, you went, they made it so you could get like SD cards now. So basically everything records to SD cards or some form of solid state flash drive with the new camcorders. And I haven't had a new camcorder in years because I use my digital SLR, which records 24 frames a second, 1080p to a SD card, which is good enough for what I'm doing now. And getting disability money right now, don't have the cash to get anything else, and I would not want to invest in anything else. So for now, I'm perfectly happy with what I have. But I might actually shoot some stuff with my mini DV camcorder for, you know, retro sake, because I got a battery that works, a double-sized battery for it. I've got 5 unused tapes that haven't been opened, plus 1 that I've opened. So, I mean, I could completely do that and make some fun old 480 videos, like, you know, going back in time 15 years. So my camera is in basically perfect working condition. It will probably stay that way because I always had it in that condition and it never really got dusty or anything. So that's great. Now, bringing this all back in and tying it into, you know, the differences of these video formats is VHS tapes generally wear out a lot faster because you watch them more than other tapes. The Video 8 tapes are prone to warping and having issues with temperature and time because we're talking 25, 30-year-old tapes. The mini DV tapes are a little more robust and they're probably going to last a hell of a lot longer. But again, they have a lot of moving parts that can eventually die. Same with hard drives and SD cards. So I had to find out a way to back up everything. So my PC, which I call the Frankenstein, is a computer that I built a few years ago when I was working full time at a company and I just wanted to get something together to play some basic games. But it's become my media consumption machine. It's in my living room in my apartment, hooked up to the TV as basically the main format that I watch TV on it. I watch movies on it. I do occasional gaming, but it's basically what I do everything on in the living room other than, you know, gaming. I have the Xbox One X and I have the PS4 Pro and the Switch hooked up to it as well. So what I have in here is it's an amalgamation of weird parts from different time periods. So I've got a Blu-ray burner in there that I use to watch most of my movies on. It's gone through 3 iterations of CPU. It's got a KB Lake-based Intel Pentium. Not an i3 or anything, just a Pentium because it uses the same video encoder and decoder as the higher-end CPUs, but only costs like $120. So it's got a dual core with hyper-threading, basic, you know, CPU, very cheap. The motherboard was about $150 because it was multi-generational. I wanted to make sure that it was one that worked with, I think it's 2 or 3 generations this board has worked with. I then have 8 gigs of RAM. I have recently in the last 3 or 4 months put a new video card in there because I just had the onboard video forever. So I popped in a GTX 1050, which lets me play everything at 1080p pretty much max for most games. And then some of the indie games or the games that are less intensive, I can do at 4K. But I wanted it so that it could output proper 4K to my TV, which is a new 4K TV. I have a Sound Blaster card in there, a Sound Blaster X, which I was using for the longest time for my sound. But now that I use HDMI for everything, I don't need it for that. But what I do use it for is to record audio input because it's a lot better quality parts than what's on the onboard sound. I use it to record my record player that I have that my dad got me last year. It's a pretty medium to higher range $500-$600 record player. And I use it to play through my TV or make backups of the record playing because I kind of like that sound that it has. So I'll back up a record or 45 and then play it digitally through my computer so I don't have to wreck the records after that. I also have recently put in a capture card that captures two different HDMI inputs at 1080p, 60 frames per second, which is cool. And then I also have the most recent acquisition, which is pretty much filled up the rest of my PCI Express slots, is I have a FireWire card, which is I got simply because I had to find a way to back up my mini DV tapes because you can't hook it up any other way. So after that, how I ended up capturing the old footage for home videos from the old High 8 and Video 8 tapes is my brother's fiance, her parents have an old High 8 camera from Sony, which works perfect. It was their family camera, so she allowed me to borrow it. And I then had to pay basically $20 to get a little box. It's not anything fancy. It's not like a FrameMeister or anything, but it lets me convert the analog signal from the RCA to an HDMI out to 1080p, which then plugs into the back of the computer through the video HDMI input capture device that I have. And then it records it like you're recording a DVR. Basically, what you see on the screen is what's playing on whatever it's plugged into it, and you have to record it at real time. So I did that for all of her home videos, all of the old home videos that we had converted to VHS, and even had a videotape that had our Simpsons. There was a Simpsons special in 93 that aired the first four, I think it was, Simpsons Halloween specials on Fox, and we taped them all in a row, and we have all the commercials on it. That was the tape that we watched the most, so it's pretty damaged, but it was fun to get all the old commercials off there, and I'll probably be doing something with those commercials in the future, because it's basically a time capsule from 1993 of two different stations. The first half of the tape is the Simpsons stuff, which has all the WTV Buffalo Fox 29s commercials on there. And the end of the tape has a bunch of stuff recorded from what is now called Omni One in Canada, but used to be called CFTO in Kitchener, in Toronto, which is one of the bigger broadcasters now, for at least provincially, and maybe even over across Canada. So there's a bunch of local ads for things like wake-up services, where you would call, pay a dollar, and then they would phone you to wake you up in the morning. You know, before the days of hotels having alarm clocks or people having like cell phones even, right? So this is like 1993, 94. So it's really interesting stuff. So anyway, so I backed all that up, and then I realized that the rest of our home videos were either missing or had already been converted to VHS. So I had to make a trip to my mom's because she has a VHS player, a good JVC player that we bought for my brother in like 99, and it still works perfect. So I had to borrow a VHS player and hook that up through the capture devices. And my living room was a maze of cables and hilarious old technology Frankensteined into the Frankenstein machine. So I backed up our home videos from there. Like I've got my sixth birthday where, you know, that's just for me, but my seventh birthday, my brother was a year old, so we've got him on there. So I'm trying to capture all these clips for his wedding, and it's pretty fun doing that. And then I find out that the mini DV camcorder doesn't seem to want to communicate with the FireWire card. The FireWire card's installed, but it doesn't want to find the device. And I find out it might be an issue with Windows 10 being too new for FireWire. So I'm going to have to do some workarounds to get that to work, which is interesting. But it's basically, it was making me think of, you know, how technology has changed, and how if you don't back these things up or future-proof them in some way, you're going to lose them eventually because they'll stop working. So what I've done is I digitized everything at a super high data rate at 1080p. I've done no digital noise reduction, but I have done some audio cleanup because it can be a little fuzzy audio. And I'm going to be putting everything on like a Blu-ray as a backup, just a Blu-ray data backup, no fancy menus or anything, just the files, because like 1 or 2 hours of these can be like 60 gigs or more. So I have to shrink them down just enough to fit on there, but not enough to lose any quality. And I'm also backing everything up because my brother and I share a family plan on Google Drive. So we have 2 terabytes of space. So I'm going to be backing stuff up there. So you want to have a couple backups, because eventually these moving parts on all these drives are going to stop working, or you'll lose the tapes, or environmentally you might magnetically erase them. And I think some of our home videos have been magnetically erased. The only way to check for sure is I may have to go for and find myself a Sony Digital 8 tape player to play back some of the High 8 tapes that would have had maybe digital stuff recorded, because playing that back through an analog device would show nothing but static. So who knows? And there may be still some more videos for me to back up, but you know, I am glad that everything now is in a digital point where I can back it up to any physical media that I want, but that the original stuff won't degrade further, you know, maybe making it impossible for me to back up, because I'm not going to go and pay $20 or $30 to a backup service to back up the tapes and then find out there's only 1 minute of things in there or nothing at all. I'd rather spend $100 on equipment that I can do to back it up myself, and then I can sell the equipment or use it in the future or have something that way. I want to be self-sufficient with it and self-reliant. So, you know, that's interesting to me. Like, it's something that if you have any experiences with home videos or the horrors of losing them, or if you remember, you know, what camcorders or what you did to record with, it'd be something, you know, send us some feedback at thisweekingeek.net or Alex at thisweekingeek.net. Hit us up on Twitter. I'm at DeathPhaseTwig. You'll see me on there, or hit me up on Facebook. It'd be interesting to hear, like, your different experiences with it, because I know it'll be different, especially if you're in Europe and you use, like, different formats, like PAL stuff. You know, digital video and even digital pictures, the formats were changing so quickly that we lost a lot of stuff. Like, I know that our first digital camera was a 3-megapixel camera, and my dad got one that was, like, a brand new thing. There's a lot of photos that are gone because we forgot to save them properly. Like, I have a lot of pictures on our old Kodak film, and I've got a lot of newer pictures backed up to Facebook, anything in the last, like, 15 years. But there's a period of about 5 or 6 years where there's a lot of pictures we don't have anymore. And I remember my very first time using a digital camera was at school in grade 6, I think, for track and field, because I was the fat kid that couldn't do much. I did my track stuff, and then the teacher said, hey, why don't you take pictures for our school yearbook, which I have no idea if that even exists because it's grade 6 yearbook. But they gave us a basically looked like a Polaroid camera, and it took floppy disks, and you could take like 5 pictures or 6 pictures at 640 by 480, and that was it. But it blew my mind that you could take a picture and put it on a disk. So that was my first experience there, and that's what probably got me hooked. I wanted to make videos with it, but you couldn't. So the closest I could do was take 5 still pictures of moving something slightly on a desk and making an animated GIF when I was like 12 or 13. So yeah, that's pretty much it with that. Moving on to the next topic. Yeah, the next thing I want to talk about just briefly for a minute is the trend of movie theaters changing how they operate. Basically, the other day I went and saw Avengers Endgame. There's not going to be any spoilers. I won't spoil anything. But I did have part of the movie experience ruined for me by the power went out. And when the power went out for 5 minutes, the whole place died. Basically, even the emergency lights died. So nothing was working at all. And then when it came back on, only the audio was working. It was sort of chaos. And the manager's running around with her head chopped off, like a chopped off chicken head. I messed that up. But anyway, it was kind of crazy because it was one person to basically control the entire theater. Like the kids that were working there couldn't give us refunds until after the show. They could give us coupons or whatever for the next viewing, but they couldn't turn the screens on. Only one person, manager, had the rights to turn on and had the keys to turn on everything. 12 screen theater, large theater. I had a friend that used to work there, and you know, there'd be at least more than one projectionist, or there'd be somebody whose job was just to be the projectionist. The manager would be going around doing everything else, but there'd be one person at least checking on everything. Now that it's all digital, instead of, you know, film flying everywhere, you have, when they all go down, they have to reboot. There's a process. It's a pain in the ass, and they have to give out coupons to everybody for new movies and stuff because we lost 15 minutes of time. That's a 3-hour movie, and we had 15 minutes where we had nothing to do. And people got scared because they couldn't leave the theater because they couldn't see anything. Even the emergency lights went out. So they need to maintain these things. The issue I have, you know, my rant is going to come to an end here, but it's, you can't double the ticket price in the last 15 years. Double the ticket price, reduce the staff to a quarter of the staff, double or triple the food price, and then, you know, expect it to be fine and then have nothing go wrong. When something goes wrong now, instead of it being up and running in about 30 seconds and everything's fine, nobody complains, you end up having to give out free passes. You know, they had to give out like 600, like 600 people had to have free movies now. That's a lot more money than it would have been just to staff it with 1 or 2 extra people that had the right to actually turn the projectors back on. It's just, it's kind of ludicrous to me. And I mean, it's not the manager's fault. I was trying to be, you know, nice enough to her, but at the same time, it's like, come on, somebody. So I think a lot of people called the corporate head office and be like, you can't do this. And I know an issue I've heard is that this was a Disney film, obviously. Disney and some of the other companies are now taking a much larger cut of ticket sales. Well, it's like, okay, that's fine, but you spend like $25 on popcorn now, so it's getting a little ridiculous. I went because I wanted to see it before it was spoiled for me by everybody else, but I prefer, for the most part, going to local theaters like the Apollo in downtown Kitchener, which is a mixture of like an art house theater, and they show modern stuff too. They have, you know, a good projector. It's only a 2K, so like basically 1080p, but it's blown up really well optically. But it's made by their projector's made by Christie Digital, which is local to Kitchener, instead of Barco, one of these companies where it's from somewhere overseas. So, you know, Christie Digital makes really, really high-end projectors. They provided one and a full 7.1 surround system, or Atmos surround system, to the theater downtown. The theater downtown Apollo also has they have the chairs where the armrests go up if you're a fat person, or if you're somebody who wants to, like, you know, lean in with their girlfriend or boyfriend, or just you want a little extra room or something. They also have, for the first five rows, tables. So they have extra leg room, and then there's tables that you share with each seat. Each seat has a table where you can rest your food on. And it's pretty cool. And they do really cool events, like having breakfast days where you go there on like a Saturday and you have unlimited cereal while you watch cartoons, and they show like old cartoons. So they do that's the sort of stuff I'd want to support, is something local. And their prices are basically $2 or $3 cheaper than going to the mainstream theater, even though you're getting new movies. And for instance, if you go to a Cineplex or a Landmark cinema here, and you want to get a ticket, a regular price ticket, you're looking at about $11. And then if you want a popcorn, a large popcorn drink, and where you can maybe have a refill on one or the other, but not both, you end up paying another $16 or so, $16 or $18. So it's like $30 after taxes for you to see a movie and have a large popcorn and drink, if that's what you want. If you go to the Apollo and you pay for a membership, which is $10 per year, you can see a movie for $8. That's your ticket price instead of $11. And for $8.55, the price hasn't raised in like 3 years since they've 3 or 4 years since they've been open. For $8.55, you get a large popcorn, large drink, free butter on it, real butter, not the weird crap. And you get unlimited refills on the drink and unlimited refills on the popcorn. So they also do a double feature deal where for $12, you can see two features. So you can see two movies for $20 and then have unlimited refills on your popcorn. So you can have basically two meals and two movies for $20. So it's a no-brainer to me. It's just that they don't always have the newest. Like, they'll get the Avengers, but they'll get the Avengers in like 3 weeks is when they'll get it. They're like the second run theater for that. They're a first run theater for art picks, independent features, and that sort of stuff. They also show a lot of things, like they'll do anime craze, where they'll throw on a bunch of anime movies. Like, they'll do the Studio Ghibli festival, where they'll show like 20 other movies. So, and then they also do, you know, second run of major theater. Oh, sorry, excuse me, hiccups here. Major theater runs. So, like, for instance, when Jurassic World ended in major theaters, they got it for the next 2 weeks, sort of thing. Which is fine. For a lot of movies, you don't have to go see them right away, and you can see them after. And I'm only using them as an example because there's other theaters in town here. There's Frederick Twin, or it's called Imagine Cinemas now, and it's sort of the cheap theater. They get movies right away, like the first week. They're a first-run theater, but they're a smaller, older theater. They actually got seats from the old Chinese Grammys Theater in Los Angeles, like Hollywood, which is kind of interesting. But there's the seats. They're rocker seats, but they're old rocker seats from like 20 years ago, so they're not that great. They're kind of snug. But they have two smaller screens, and they usually have one family feature and then one more mature feature. And they'll do things like Tuesdays, $4.50 for a ticket. We used to have Toonie Tuesdays back in like 15, 20 years ago, but $4.50 for a movie is great. And then they'll do a popcorn deal for like $10. You get a popcorn and a drink. So that's not bad. They're a little more strict. Like, you can't bring backpacks in there or anything. Like, my brother ended up having a fight with them over the fact that he had to have his own snacks because he's a type 1 diabetic, and they cannot by law expect him to pay for their snacks if he's a type 1 diabetic. And they didn't care. They tried to confiscate his bag, and he made a big stink. And they were in the paper for the management having to be re-educated on the Ontario laws, basically. By law, they cannot refuse that to a diabetic. So they've had some of their ups and downs because they're just the cheap theater, but they've gone through that and come out better in the long run. So there are other options, but I was just surprised that a theater that is the second biggest chain in Canada didn't have a contingency plan for when the power went out, and it was sort of, you know, crazy. So that being said, that's the end of my of my rant on this. So I just think that if for movie theaters to survive, they're going to have to increase the quality of service that they have, because the little guys are doing so much better that way. So that's going to be it for basically, you know, my two little topics here. And we're going to go into a review that I got a copy from Saber Interactive's World War Z on the Xbox One X. And then after that, I believe I'm going to come back and sort of introduce another review, because I forgot when I started doing the show that I promised we were going to put in the Book of Unwritten Tales 2 that Mr. Tristifer had recorded, that I thought we had already released, but we hadn't. So we're going to put that actually right after this review, and then I'll come back to close it out the show, and we'll see what's up next for us and Twig.
This is a fair request, and I promise I will not judge any person only as a teenager, and that this is no more right than saying all teenagers are drunken dope addicts or glue sniffers.
It's 2019, and that is the year of Alex trying new games and new game styles that he's not normally used to, because he said, to hell with being normal and doing what I just always did and only doing like JRPGs, and which I'm still going to do, and your standard sort of action games. I wanted to branch out and try something different. I started a bit earlier in the year with visual novel games, and I'll probably be doing more of those now. Lately I've been trying, okay, you know, screw it, I'm going to do some horror style games, things that I wouldn't normally do that are outside of my wheelbox. And one of the first ones that I've got here to talk about is World War Z. Now, this game was provided to us by Saber Interactive, and I got a Xbox review code for it. So it's out right now, and I'm going to talk just briefly about what I thought about it. You know, to sum it up, it's basically Left 4 Dead meets, you know, the movie and book property World War Z. You get to go through multiple acts of the story, and it's a very co-op intensive game. Like, you're playing, it's four characters, you play online, and there is an offline mode, but for the most part, you're playing online in co-op mode to try to complete whatever missions that you have. It's like blowing things up, defending certain areas, traveling through trains. It's very, very cool and interesting, and you play out different locales from the book and movie. Now, I found that I'm trying to decide how to go about this, in that, do I talk about the good first, the bad first? I'm going to probably talk about the few things I didn't like first. And again, it's very few, because this game, you know, it's not obviously as story intensive as you'd think, because it's made to be very similar to like a Left 4 Dead game, where you're basically squad based shooting and defending. And so what I didn't care for was, you know, I'm somebody who likes a big narrative in a game, so that's not the style of game. So I didn't like that there wasn't as big of a narrative as I'd hoped for, especially being based on a book and being based on properties like this. I would say, other than that, there wasn't really much to dislike. I actually really enjoyed playing this game. So from a graphics perspective, I played it on the Xbox One X in 4K. No HDR, because my TV doesn't have a proper HDR mode. It has one of those crappy simulated HDRs, which is disappointing. But my TV is very crisp and clear and has really, really good color reproductions. So I was playing it in 4K on the One X, and I found it to be very serviceable. This isn't going to, you know, push the system to its limits. I would say that you were probably going to have, like, I was playing with people online, and they were having some frame rate drops playing at 1080p on the original Xbox. I'm not sure if they were playing on the S or not, but they were saying they were having some frame rate drops and things were popping up on the screen. So there could be multiple factors there. I'm playing probably in one of the most ideal conditions, in that I have HDR mode off, which usually stresses the system more, but I'm playing it at 4K on a 1X over a gigabit connection, in that, you know, it's got a gigabit port on the back, and my actual internet is, like, I have a gigabit internet at home. So, you know, I wasn't having any lag that way. So it could be that they had some lag. There might be some network connectivity issues, but they were having frame rate drops, and I was having it, you know, buttery smooth. So for me, I'm playing it at 4K, 60 frames a second, buttery smooth, and there are hundreds and hundreds of zombies on the screen. and my system didn't make a peep. It wasn't even over, like, heating up. It wasn't making any noise. You know, this is a game that is well optimized for the Xbox One X. It is available on other platforms, like the Epic Game Store on PC, and as well as on the PS4, and that. I have no idea, you know, how it plays on there. I'm saying it plays buttery smooth. If you got an Xbox One X, you're going to have a pretty good time with that. Now, as far as graphics go, like I said, it's not going to, you know, win any awards for the best character models. It does have very interesting deaths, the way you can kill the enemies and the zombies. You can blast apart body parts, hit them in the head, all that sort of fun stuff. You're basically, you know, teaming up, and you have turrets you can use. There's a whole bunch of different ways to play that way. And it's super duper fun, except one thing I found interesting. There's some balance issues with the controls. The controls are very concise and tight, and shooting and aiming and everything is really cool. And there's different reload points throughout the game that you can reload your weapons at. I found, except in very limited circumstances, that the melee attacks, using like your knives and everything to, you know, bust them up, was actually more effective than using some of the weapons, even the heavy artillery, because you basically hit the right button on the top of your controller, and you're basically slashing them, and it jumps from person to person to slash, and I'm like slash, 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 slash. So I'm getting like 100, 150, 200, 300 kills using that. And it's one slash to kill them, whereas you could, if you're not very good at aiming, you could be shooting bullets and using up all your ammo. I could kill five people in the time that my other teammates would take to kill one just by shooting. So I'm not sure if that's a balancing issue that they can probably tweak out, make it maybe so you need to use two or three slashes with your melee attack to kill them. Now, I had super fun doing that, so whether it be broken or, you know, design intention, I'm perfectly fine with that because I had a very, very fun time. I do see it being a game that I will pop up every now and then, and I hope some of my friends pick it up on the Xbox so that I'm able to actually go and then just basically play in a half hour to an hour, play a few missions online, you know, with the multiplayer mode, or play through the story mode again, and just, you know, kill some time, killing a bunch of zombies. It's really fun seeing, you know, giant waves of zombies come on the screen at once, because they truly do completely pile up on the screen. And there are some different types. You've got the large, basically tank ones that you got to take down that are hard to shoot, but again, you can slash them up four or five times with your melee attack. The audio design is really good. Because I'm playing this on the Xbox One X, and I also have a fairly modern surround receiver, I only have a 5.1 setup, but my system is set to go to Dolby Atmos, so it has positional spatial 3D audio, and I found it was, for a game, you know, of this caliber, it was really, really good with positional audio. I could hear everybody around me. If you're going through a mission, and let's say somebody in the one building is telling you what you're supposed to be doing, depending on where you run, the positional audio gets louder or quieter in certain areas, so, you know, it's not like all the audio comes out of left and right or just out of the center speaker for talking. It's all around you, so it's very well designed that way. And I fully think that this is a great pick-up-and-play game, so you're going to want to check it out now. Check it out, like I said, on the Epic Game Store for PC. Check it out on Xbox and on PS4. Saber Interactive did a pretty good job putting this out, and I think, you know, it's going to stand out above and beyond some of the other titles in its class, because it was pretty, pretty good.
Do you have any hobbies?
I collect spores, molds, and fungus.
Hold that thought. It's crapper time.
The Book of Unwritten Tales 2, originally released in 2015, was recently ported to the Nintendo Switch, as so many lesser-known gems have been lately, and this game is no exception. Developed by King Art, The Book of Unwritten Tales 2 is essentially a point-and-click adventure that will have you solving puzzles to advance the story, all while having a lot of hearty laughs and the comedy strewn throughout the entire game. The four main characters from the original Book of Unwritten Tales return, but if you haven't played the first one, like me, it doesn't seem all that important. The first game is referenced, but enough context is given that you won't be left scratching your head. The humor in this game cannot be understated. Everything has a layer of comedy in it, from amusing conversations with NPCs to sly references to other games or tropes. I found myself laughing more than playing half the time, and spending far too long with certain NPCs with amusing dialogue options. Many point-and-click games have static and almost boring backgrounds, but Book of Unwritten Tales 2 is certainly not one of them. The environments are gorgeous, with little details that bring them to life, like the fluttering of leaves, or in the case of one pipe-smoking ent, little billowing clouds of smoke as he puffs away. Nothing really feels static, and with so many objects to interact with on screen, you really feel like you're part of this world, instead of a moving piece on top of it. The characters themselves are also very lively. Sitting idle might mean blending into the background in many adventure games from days past, but here you'll find varied and often silly idle animations that make the characters more believable and more likable. On top of these beautiful visuals is a wealth of voice and audio design. The voices have a refreshingly diverse group of accents and styles, which is more than many fantasy settings can boast. You really get a sense of whimsy as you traverse the world, with an orchestrated soundtrack that helps bring the world to life. Gameplay itself is rather typical of point-and-clicks, with puzzles to solve and the solution usually being some variation of find things to stuff in your pockets, then figure out where they go and how they interact with each other. But the formula works, and the effects these objects have on the world around you is visceral enough to stop it from feeling stale or repetitive. Each item you grab has its own blurb of information about it, so you can find even more depth, and often comedy, should you choose to stop and smell the roses, so to speak. There were a few points where I felt a little bored at some repetition in RNG. Early on, you'll need to fish up an item of importance, and how long it takes you to fish it up is largely based on luck, though each time you fish, your fishing skill increases by one, making it seem like it's more likely to happen each time. This may all just be another witty reference to grinding skill levels in games such as World of Warcraft, but even so, after spending nearly 10 minutes fishing with my notoriously bad luck, I was quite relieved when the item I was after finally decided to show up. It's a blemish on an otherwise well-paced gameplay experience. A very much appreciated feature is a button to press that will reveal all objects on screen that you can interact with, avoiding the problem of missing one tiny detail and getting stuck forever. It doesn't feel cheap, as you still need to solve the puzzles all by yourself with minimal hints given by dialogue, so it's a welcome inclusion to the genre. I thoroughly enjoyed the Book of Unwritten Tales 2. The comedy had me howling at times, and giggling at others, all while enjoying a genre of game I don't usually play. If you're new to point-and-click adventures, this game will spoil you for all the others, so if you're going to play one, this is the one I recommend. Until the next review, I'm Mr. Tristifer for ThisWeekInGeek.net.
Alrighty, and that's going to be the end of the show for this week. Thanks to Mr. Tristifer for that review, and thanks to both Sony Interactive and Saber for the review copies that I received for their games. Now, what is coming up? I am going to, in the next day or so, visit Birdman's place, and we're going to kick out a couple reviews. I believe we're getting the PDP controller, his perspective on that, in the upcoming show very soon. Probably be on another TurdOrTreasure since we're doing this more frequently. I have been also reviewing the Mortal Kombat game, as well as Birdman's been doing his copy as well. So that's going to be on the show this week, the main show. My review of Days Gone will be included on the show as well, coming up this week. I had a pretty good time with that. I've had a fair bit of things on the go. We've got a bunch of reviews coming in. Not doing anything particular that way. We're going to be recording more Cambridge Chronicles on the go from home, and that's, I'm slowly starting to edit the episodes for that so we get it all prepared for the summertime when we're ready to launch it. Now, my schedule, I should be on all the shows coming up in the next few weeks, but my schedule is going to be a little erratic because this coming Saturday I'm going to be throwing my brother's bachelor party, which he wanted it low-key. We're not doing any strippers or anything weird like that because it's just not his jam. It's not his friend's jam, and it's not mine either. So we're not heavy. We're not drinkers. We're not partiers. I would still do it if he wanted it, but you know, he's a computer programmer. His groomsmen are computer programmers. I'm a technical background sort of guy, and that doesn't mean anything in particular. It's just his friends are more timid and more introverted. I'm probably one of the most extroverted people he knows, and so we're doing something different. We're going to this place called the Round Table. It used to be called the Watchtower, and if you were at GenreCon in Guelph, they were there. They're really cool people. They're the ones that had the Infinity Gauntlet that Birdman took his picture. I think it still might be his profile picture, or was one of his profile pictures for a while. They had all the toys to play with, like the Infinity Gauntlet, And they're a restaurant that's fantasy themed and really cool. So I made reservations for about four or five of us there. So we're going there for lunch. There's also going to be, I think, a Smash tournament there. So if you're local and you're going to be in the Waterloo area, that's the place to be if you want to, I guess, come hang out with my brother and me and his friends for his bachelor party. We're going to have lunch there. Then he wants to go to an arcade. So we're going to go to the new barcade that opened up in the last, I think, 6 months to a year, maybe, the Pinup Arcade. So might grab a drink and then play some arcade games and some pinball. And then we're going to see, maybe we want to go see a movie. We're not 100% sure. But if that's it, we're going to call it quits because one of his groomsmen is, a father with some kids, young children. So it's a matter of us, we're young. Like his friends and everybody, they're all in their 20s. And I'm, just 32. So we're not old, but we're not young. So we're going to play it by ear that way. And I asked his fiance, is like, do you want us to go see strippers? She's like, no, because that would make mine sound much more lame because she's doing a pottery class with her bridesmaids, which I was like, so everybody's doing a lame, nerdy party? And she's like, yeah. So, I guess we're not doing the strippers thing. Who knows? Maybe I'll strip for them. That'll be terrifying. And then they'll never want it again. So after that, the weekend after, obviously, the Saturday is going to be the wedding and I'm the best man. So I got to put together just a little speech you do. I'm not really that nervous because I'm not really going to be doing a big, big speech. It's just going to be a few little things from the heart, and then that's going to be it. So we're going to have photos from that. I got to take some photos with them, and we got the suit tailored and all ready. So we're good to go that way. And then it's back to pretty much normal. For anybody that's followed me on Facebook and that over the last few years, like I've talked about it even on the show, that I had weight loss surgery. I had a gastric sleeve done. And I sort of stalled after losing 50, 60 pounds more than I had before the surgery. And it's sort of the body's reacting in a way where it doesn't want to lose weight. And I've been retaining water. I've had lymphedema, swelling issues in my leg, which has led me to not being able to work because it's just too much joint pain and stuff. So I've been trying to exercise and do the best I can to lose more and more weight and get things in order. But it's looking more and more like I'm going to have to do the second step of the process, which is to do a full gastric bypass. It's not much more invasive than what I already had done, but it is a rewiring of things. What I had done initially was they removed 90% of your stomach, like the actual internals of the stomach, not like the fat, just the internals. And now what they're going to do is rewire how things work down there. But we're going to see how that goes. I have a couple months where I got to track the food that I'm eating, as well as track the exercise and everything. I'm going to have to go get a bunch of blood work done, an EKG, test everything. Basically, everything I had done for my surgery last time, where I'm actually blood work-wise in better health now than I was then, so I don't foresee it being any issue. But in somewhere in the next realm of, 6 to 12 months, I'll probably be having a second major surgery on that, and then we'll see what happens there. So I've got that on the go. More blood work, more doctor's appointments, that sort of crap. I'm not unhealthy or any unhealthier than I was before. I'm just trying to do preventative stuff, and we're trying to see where I have to go from there. So I know Birdman has been looking into it himself to get stuff done, and he was put on hold when he had his amputation. So things are starting to move in the right direction for everybody right now. So I've been a little sort of stressed under the weather with things going on. But, things are moving now, so I'm pretty happy with where things are going. And we'll see from there what ends up happening. But that's basically going to be my next few months is doing that. And I'm also going to have to probably in the fall, I'm going to be looking for a new apartment because I think roommate and I are going to be splitting. He wants to move closer to where he works in Guelph. And I've got all my family and everything here in Kitchener. So I got to find a place that's reasonably priced that I can afford. Or see what kind of part-time work I can do from home, especially if I'm going to be having a major surgery where I'll be out of commission for several months. We'll see what happens there. So either way, I'm keeping busy with the review stuff, keeping busy with all this sort of TWIG stuff. I just love doing podcasting, doing all the background stuff, doing all this. We're trying to grow the audience as much as we can. And it's a difficult thing to do because you don't have a lot of money to put into it. Some of the bigger podcasts and everything, they do have a lot of marketing behind them, but what we have is a very loyal and awesome fan base. I know, especially Birdman, you've been with him for, nearly, 11, 12 years you've been with him now. And it's just, I know it warms his heart every time he sees comments from everybody, because, you know, he has his ups and downs, and he lives his life completely on social media, so he doesn't hide anything from you guys. If he's having a bad day, he lets you guys know. I'm a little more different in that I don't keep it to myself or internalize. It's just, I tend to only post if I have a really good day or a really bad day. I keep some things personal, and for the most part I am pretty happy with everything. So I know that with Birdman, if you know, if he's feeling down or he posts that he's had a contemplative day or something, you know, he always loves it when people, you know, will let them know, you know, what he means to them and that sort of thing. So, you know, if you ever have a chance, hit him up on, you know, at Birdman Dodd on Twitter. Hit him up on Facebook, you know, Mike Dodd. He always loves to hear back from fans, because I don't think he realizes how many people he's touched over the years, and how much this podcast means to everybody. I was a fan when I started listening to this. You know, I was commuting to work every day, and this was something that I always wanted to do, and I never thought that I would be part of it. And basically, I'm running Twig in the background. I do all the background stuff. I'm the tech guy. Birdman's the creative guy on the front end. He's the face of the company and everything. And, you know, we found a really good dynamic. Mr. Tristifer, you know, he works full-time, but he's a main integral part of the Cambridge Chronicles, as well as whenever he does any of his reviews and is part of the main Twig show. He's you know, a great facet to it. There's been a revolving door of people over the years, but the constant has been Birdman, and we're trying to keep that rolling and moving it forward into the future. We want to improve the website and do a bunch of other stuff, and things will be coming in the future. We're trying to make sure we have more consistent content, which is why I'm just leading this into pretty much every week we have the Twig flagship show. We want to also have a Turtle Treasure or some sort of other show. If not a Turtle Treasure, we'll alternate with like a commentary, or we do the prototype show. We're trying to have some people come back for that. And then we've also got the occasional, basically monthly or so often, the Mayhem Mics, which is the co-production with the Geekcast Radio Network on wrestling shows. We've also got Nerd to the Third that Birdman is a part of now that we syndicate in our programming. And we do also do, whenever we do crossovers with the Geekcast Radio Network for Future Imperfect, the Star Trek / sci-fi podcast. So we want to have it so that we have at least 2 to 3 items every week that we have out for you guys to listen to. So we're going to try to do that. And over the summer, as it gets really, really hot and hard to record in you know, comfortably, we're going to try to bank a lot of the commentaries and all those extra fun shows that we can throw out there. And then we'll probably end up doing more and more, like we've been doing, recording over Discord for the main show. We can do it at nighttime when it's cooler in our own spaces. And I end up, I do the raw editing on that as far as the audio mixing. And then Mike does all the post-production part where he adds the music, adds the segments and everything together. So how that works is when we're recording locally, we end up recording with everybody plugged into one mixer. And it sort of comes out as like a mono track for all the vocals. And it's just a limitation of the technology. And it sounds fine. Most podcasts are like that. But I've always been a fan of having spatial awareness and stereo separation in audio. When we record using Discord, how we've been doing it, I set it up so that we record that way. It ends up recording us all in separate tracks, but it keeps us all in sync so that I can then go and edit panning of it. So basically I'll have one person in the center that is on both speakers, and you can have one person a little to the left or a little to the right, and it gives a spatial awareness of where we are, and it's sort of set up the way we would normally sit in a room together when we record. So I end up liking that because it means if one person is too quiet, I can boost them without boosting everybody else. If there's noise in the background, which sometimes happens at Birdman's place because where he lives, it can be noisy on the outside, or you have Blair or the cats interrupting, or there's a fire or something. So I'm able to edit that down a little bit and sort of compress the audio as need be for each individual voice. And I think you might have noticed in the last few weeks, last month, month and a half, it's really improved the quality of, not the quality of the programming, but the quality of the actual audio. So we're hoping to record more and more like that. We're going to try to find a way to do it the same way that when we're all together, it has that same quality. But it might involve some trickery or something. Maybe you have to bring a laptop and each record separately on the thing. Who knows? We'll see what happens. But that's sort of a behind-the-curtain look at what's been going on. So upcoming this week, we should be having a Twig on Monday. We usually record on Sundays or record early Mondays and then release it. It used to be always out by Sunday, but we've gotten to the point now where we found it more convenient to record and release on Mondays. So usually Monday evenings that will be coming out. Then Tuesday or Wednesday, depending on when it's launched, is usually a Nerd to the Third. And then we usually have we'll have a third or a third and fourth podcast sometime near the end of the week. So that's sort of going to be the schedule. It is going to be up in the air based on people's availability, sickness, that sort of crap. So that's going to be it. I've been rambling on long enough now, so I got to go and play some more Mortal Kombat to record the review the next day or two with Birdman. So until then, I'll talk to you people later.
Well, that's our show.
All right, here's the deal. Every time you watch my show, I will send you $40.
Checks will not be honored.
You've been listening to This Week in Geek, your source for guaranteed nonsense or your money back. Tune in next week for more info on the most important things you didn't need to know. Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net and subscribe to our podcast through iTunes or any podcatcher. If you'd like to comment on this episode, head over to this episode's post at thisweekingeek.net and leave a comment through Facebook Connect. Follow us on Twitter at thisweekingeek.net and follow our Instagram at twig_official_podcast. Social media not your thing? Send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. We'll see you next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
Just when you think this show is terrible, something wonderful happens.
What?
It ends.
I have to go. Somewhere there is a crime happening.
Yeah!
Oh, great. What's his name?
Eric Cartman.
Cartman! Yeah!
Okay, age?
He's 9.
Okay, and what's his disability?
He's retarded.
Johnny got a toy golf set when he was 3, and from that day on, he was hooked. All he wanted to do was golf, golf, golf. He'd be on the links before school, after school. All he ever wanted was to go pro. And then, one day, when he was holding his grandson and thinking about his 12 handicap, Johnny realized it just might not happen for him. But you know what did happen for him? He switched to Geico and saved a bunch of money on car insurance. So that was good. And so was hanging out with his grandson.
Geico presents yet another voicemail from your roommate.
Hi. So about the kitchen. Turns out when there's a grease fire, you're not supposed to throw water on it. Who would have known, right? Anyways, the fire department is here and it's totally cool. Give me a call back when you get a chance.
The Geico Insurance Agency could help keep your personal property protected, like if danger is your roommate's middle name. Visit geico.com to see how easy it is to switch and save on renter's insurance.